There is a tale long forgotten about precious and unique being named Flake. Who was it that gave him spark of life was never known. Some say he was a natural heir. The story tells that Blake's body was only water, held together by coldness of his heart. They say Flake was pure evil, and that he was searching for worse in everyone. But no one knows for sure who he was, and what was the true color of his heart.
Adventure gave me some riddles, great and small. Adventure gave me
adventure games, he loves them all. Every day is a new quest, exploring north, south, east, and west. Point and click to find the answers that we seek. Adventure gave me.
Hello there, fellow adventurers! Flake the Legend of Snowblind is a game that enchanted me in a way I can't quite describe, so I brought the developer on to help me, who goes by the nickname Dux.
My nickname is Dux, as you know, but my name is Duje Šegvić. It's Croatian name, it's a name based on the saint protector of my city, Split. I'm architect by trade, designing houses, mostly creative person. I am addicted to creation, so if I don't create something today, I'm like depressed. So it's like it's my drug.
Have you ever felt the silence of the mountain, falling snow, close to blindness?
The game is set on an island which bears a strange resemblance to another island somewhere deep in the Caribbean. A meteor falls from the sky and crashes into the snow-capped mountain, leaving a crystal that cracks open and a white blob falls out.
Actually, the Flake character was born, I was just looking through my sketches and stuff 20 years ago. At that time, it was 2005, I actually made small game, which was freeware. In similar direction it went with the Flake and changing shapes and stuff. And then years passed and 2017, it came back to me that I maybe should try to make it better, larger. And so from then, now 7 years, this is slowly in creation.
Wow, amazing. I can see whole island from here, but how do I get down?
So, what is this creature that looks like a cross between a Smurf and Paradigm? Like Duck said, the prototype for Flake was a short game back in 2005 called Snowblind that introduces the character of Flake, who has a heart meter which measures how hot or cold he is, and he can change shape depending on his actions. For example, if we throw snowballs down on people, he'll turn into an ice monster and become stronger. We can change back again by doing good deeds like putting a stray birdie back in its nest. Snowblind is important for introducing this concept, as well as being the only adventure game I know which features the theme from Grizzly Adams. Getting back to Flake the Legend of Snowblind, the tagline calls it the coldest adventure ever.
Well, but that's funny, because I called it initially at Twitter. At the time I was thinking about Kickstarter campaign, like, I want to make it stick out and it's cold, and let's make it coldest. I'm not saying it's best, I'm not saying it's coolest, but it's just coldest. And then it was funny situation, because I'm not sure how the game is called. Then the other developer was making point and click game, which is also based in, I don't know, Siberia, very cold. And we got into the discussion whose game is colder, who gets the title. Yeah.
I can't say which game is colder, as only the trailer for Echidna's Daughter was released in 2019. The developer Matsy Klein's other game, Planet of the Sleepy Dogs, was number 2 in my top 10 Adventure X Jam video.
There's really a lot of sleeping going on in this game, isn't there? Right, Potu? Potu?
So what makes Flakes so cold? Well, the island Ron is stuck in an endless winter that's perfect weather for polar bears, who are the first creatures we encounter. But they're just the tip of the iceberg of the numerous characters that Dux has created, not all of which appear in the game and have their own story.
Each character I made, I tried to imagine like he can have his own game, you know. Mentioning characters, the little bears, the first one you arrive to, they are a little childish because they are like children bears, but the voices that they got was from my children.
Hello, what is your name?
Hi, I'm Mojeros, but friends can call me Mojo.
I'm Flash.
I'm Flash.
No, Simon, your name is Simon.
Nice.
So it was really interesting for me, and I gave them really characters of my children. They are exactly, you don't know them, but who knows them, you can exactly recognize. This one doesn't like reading, this one is like smart ass, this one is... So it is fun to me to... And also the mom bear is my wife's voice, so when Flay comes there, I'm talking to my family.
Shut up, Flash.
Shut up!
Boys.
Sorry, Mom.
In fact, all the voices are done by Dux along with family and friends. So if you don't like the way they sound, Mama Bear might eat you alive.
Yikes! I better back off.
Dux is of course an avid adventure gamer and couldn't resist adding in some references to the classics.
Who is Benji?
Bartender of the Skull Bar.
Skull Bar? Some strange flashbacks I'm getting here. Wait, I see. A bar full of pirates? Dog? But what does it mean?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Of course, I used many references from Monkey Island and stuff like that. I tried to put in all the things that I loved in the games. Not stealing them, but in some way reliving them because it felt good to play them. For example, Monkey Island, when you're under the sea, with that idol and stuff, that was for me amazing, like he's under the sea. Some are hidden, maybe not so noticeable. For example, I love this insult fighting is monkey, that's revolutionary. I wanted something like that, and but you cannot copy it or you don't want to, and trying to do something interesting, so that came out as Dirty Duel, you know. Also tribute to Monkey Island in some way, but something completely different.
So take this, you bleach brainless icicle head.
Ooh, nice start.
This is called the Dirty Duel, an insult contest thought up by this ghostly creature who plays the role of the baddie, though he does have a sense of humor if you like mad cow jokes.
Anyway, did you hear this one? Two cows talk. One said, did you hear about cow madness virus spreading? Other answers. Yeah. I'm so glad I'm a penguin.
Ha ha ha. Hilarious, sir. You did tell me that 100 times, but it gets funnier every time.
It was amazing because, for example, Ghost character, I was really worried about him because he's like psychotic and it's not me and I don't know how to give him a voice. But I was sick for 3 days with really sore throat. Yes. And then I was like, and then came to me, hey, I got the voice. And I was hardly talking. And I went up there and recorded 3 hours and destroyed my voice completely. But I feel it's nice and it fits, so.
Let's play rock, paper, scissors. Paper, you are rock. I win. It never gets old.
One of the main puzzles is to get through this gate by answering questions about the lore of the land, which is a great way to appreciate all the world building that adds to the game's wealth of dialogue.
It may be interesting that the game has 7,000 lines of text, which for me was... I didn't know that because I was just making a game and writing and making it. And then came the time of voice acting. And then when I pulled out the text file and I seen 7,000, I was like shocked. And I said, this will never happen. How can I record 7,000? And then I was looking, the 7,000 lines is like 300 page book. So I wrote the book. I was really shocked.
Tell me more about your expedition.
Oh, it was horrible. Memories are still fresh. The expedition started 12 days ago in attempt to find the legendary Leonite castle.
One thing maybe about main character, which I love, he refers a lot to present time in some situations for some details. So memories, which I also like to put in, because basically all the time he's referring to present, like he relived it somehow. And I find this amazing for the plot, but also for writing the plot, because you can use any reference from now and put it in the game, which is fantasy. Now he refers to a tire or some kind of, you know, he can say Tom Cruise. He can say anything, and it's fun. You don't have any limits for what you can do.
I'm Simon, the gate wizard.
Wizard? Ah, wizard. Like a sorcerer. Simon the Sorcerer. Sounds somewhat familiar.
Wake up, Mr. Dragon! The hell am I doing? I don't want to wake him.
One thing I mentioned, the letters, which is a very interesting fact for the game. Because one of the things I made is the entire alphabet of these strange letters. So. Basically all the things that are written in a game, like straight symbol from past wars and stuff, they are actual letters and they actually mean something. So basically, but you don't have a clue or decipher in the game. So basically maybe fun for some hardcore fans to try to figure out exactly what are the letters and then try to read these hidden messages.
Balls of time will fall. No. Balls of time will fall for those with pure heart.
But what does this mean?
Well, I can already say that I'm a hardcore fan, so I tried to decipher the writing for myself.
Alright, I think I got it. I'm ready to translate anything. Maybe I'm not as hardcore as I thought.
Well, here goes nothing. This feels strange.
Whoa. Oh, it works. Good luck, Flake.
I love the idea coming back to the same situation in different time or something happened. So it's devastated or characters changed. That is something I really wanted to play. So it's really what I am thinking. But the downside is... I know everything by heart, so I cannot play it like the first time. I'm waiting to get old enough to forget everything, and then I'll enjoy it finally.
I admit I got really stuck a couple times without a hint or walkthrough to help me, but rather than make me rage quit, this brought me back to a time when the solution wasn't just a click away.
I was thinking a lot about hints, you know. Many now games, they have hint system, like New Monkey, you have hint book, so you want to use it or not. But I feel we spoil players so much that they don't have the patience to try it. When we played first Monkey, at least me, you didn't have internet, you just stuck and that's it. And then you come 3 days later and we'll search. And I think now people are so much spoiled that you won't like. If you're stuck, you don't know, yeah, I don't want to play it anymore.
Are you lost, just like me?
Oh no,
I'm not lost. No. I'm furious. I can't take this anymore. Every time. Jeez. Every time I get stuck helplessly. No more adventures for me. Ever. I quit.
Later on in the game, there's a maze, which might strike fear into the hearts of some adventure gamers who've got lost in a maze one too many times. This is perfectly parodied in All Demons Must Go to Hell by the Adventure Think Tank, which aims to put all the infamous things about adventure games, such as mazes, dead ends, and moon logic, all together into what's called the most actively hostile adventure game ever created. But being the masochist that I am, I personally loved it.
That was awesome! What a great game. I really did enjoy that. I guess I'm just a masochist. I guess I just enjoy torturing myself.
The maze in Flake, though, is extremely well designed and involves combining different colored spheres to create portals that lead to other areas of the maze, which is something I don't think I've seen before.
I spent so much time thinking about concept, and I'm very happy because I feel it is original. I didn't see anything alike anywhere else. Spent a really long time because I needed like something before the end that it's interesting, that is in line with this psychotic character, and that things happen. So I was searching, and the original maze was three times larger with much more colors, but it turned out to be so much complicated that I felt I'm really torturing people. I need to take it down. So I just used basic colors and not so many portals. But I feel I'm very happy about that.
I hate this maze.
Glad to hear it.
What kind of psychopath would think of something like this?
Best kind. Priceless.
My initial impression of Flake was that it looks more like a kid's game. But as it progressed, I realized there are deeper themes that make it so much more than that, and the character of Flake is more complex than just looking like a cross between Elvis and a cornflake.
Whoa, I almost became whole water this time. Looks like I change if I do good in this world.
He is an elemental being that can change shapes. I know it's like childish cartoon graphics, but I like it that way. And that Flake character itself, especially in this game, he's very like his good-hearted character with everything is nice. You can feel this love coming out of him. But that the idea is that he's not like that all the time. So later when he changes into something else, would mess things up. So
again? Whoa, my hand and foot got frozen this time. Seems like I change if I do bad things in this world.
Dux clearly has a love for his creations, so much so that he was inspired to make sculptures out of them.
Yeah, when I was creating, I made many creatures. They are from baked clay, and you can see here, it's the entire island. So basically entire island is made, and with all locations that you encounter. So this was useful for me to make the island sketches and stuff. I needed to have it all.
It is a snowy mountain. That is where my quest started.
And you encountered Rollo?
Cool statue. Looks like mighty warrior with that axe.
And interestingly, each of these statues, I don't know if you can see, has its own gem here.
Okay, Rollo, here I come.
His guy, sidekick, writing his diary. So you can take his cap off. So this is the famous hat that is very useful in the game.
Thanks, my dear hat. I will never lose you again.
Glad to help. Nice gem.
And of course there's Flake making his tea. You can take this out on the fire.
Ooh, it's too hot. But hey, it cooled down in a second in my hand. Luckily I'm so cold.
Dux even went as far as drawing on the walls, as you can see in this video taken by someone who broke into his house looking for something to steal, but was freaked out to find this instead. Let's see a small selection of his artwork that didn't make it into the game.
Yeah, I just remember, so let me know it. So, for example, this is one of the statues that you encounter later, and it's an elephant. He is the one who made the statues. So, this is one of most important statue characters, and he made self-portrait statue. There are so many sketches I can... This is actually Io, the one that you are looking for the name. She will be this goddess or let's say guardian of the forest whisperer, who you will encounter in this forest of whispering voices, and she has one of the gems you need to take from her. And this one is a very important character. He's the wizard. He is a wizard in this temple you have to get to. He will also guide you how to change shapes and stuff.
My most important question was, why does the game start with an elephant sitting on the moon eating an ice cream?
This elephant is actually one of most important characters in the game, but you encounter it for now just at this beginning. It is it was symbolic because he is like sitting on the moon and eating ice cream, which you consider like dreamlike. It's not possible. So basically it is a dream when you open the game, and once you push him down, the dream breaks and the plot begins. So basically that is it.
Hey.
It was quite an adventure for me, and I really love doing it. So now I hope people will love playing it. And I was not planning to stop, I was planning to continue working, but then when it got to, now it's 4.5 or 5 hours gameplay, I decided it's enough. I mean, I need to see if people will like it. It's a huge project, as you can imagine, and I did everything myself. I mean, completely everything except music and half of the voices, so I guess I love impossible challenges.
So please help Dux in his impossible challenge to bring his creations to life, and go buy Flake the Legend of Snowblind. For me, this is my happy place.
Take me home, take me home.